So here's a thought experiment for you. What if you could become an Olympic athlete and run as fast and as far as Mo Farah or Usain Bolt while only doing half the work or training? Well, there are actually pills that can help you do that. These pills are known as exercise pills, and they get this name because 1. They mimic the effects of exercise on the body, and therefore 2. They make you better at exercise, improving overall exercise endurance. And one of the most popular agents in this category is GW501516, also known as Cardarine. First developed by GlaxoSmithKline in 1992 as a potential treatment for obesity, type 2 diabetes, and hypercholesterolemia, Cardarine seemed like the most promising thing ever. For a while, anyway. Despite the very promising initial results, GSK abandoned all Cardarine research in 2007 due to concerns that Cardarine was carcinogenic, with multiple animal studies reporting a wide range of cancers following Cardarine treatment. And contrary to what you may think, this did not really discourage athletes, both amateur and professional, from trying it out. In fact, a black market quickly emerged to meet this incredibly high demand, and online vendors began to sell lab-made Cardarine as a research or a not-for-human-consumption supplement.
Whatever that may mean.
In fact, I've seen multiple videos here on YouTube that actively promote Cardarine with the typical before and after pictures. What I've not seen, however, are any videos that discuss or explain the science behind how Cardarine works and how it may improve exercise endurance and why it may lead to the development of tumours. And so that is precisely what we are going to do today. My name is Hashim, and this is Dr. Tell Me Why, a medical channel where I explain the science behind optimizing your health. This video is part one of a three-part series. In 2 weeks' time, I'll be publishing a video all about the science behind the fat burner DNP, or 2,4-dinitrophenol, and why you should absolutely never use it. So if you'd like to watch that, then make sure you hit the subscribe button. Cardarine improves exercise endurance by activating a group of receptor proteins known as peroxisome proliferator activated receptor, or just PPAR for short. Broadly speaking, there are three subtypes of these PPAR proteins, alpha, delta, and gamma, and Cardarine appears to be over 1,000 times more selective for the delta subtype. Incidentally, the delta subtype is overly represented in skeletal muscle, outnumbering PPAR alpha and PPAR gamma in skeletal muscle by tenfold and 50-fold respectively. This probably has something to do with the fact that PPAR delta plays an important role in fat metabolism, which happens to be the main source of energy in endurance type exercises. In short, PPAR delta activates genes inside your muscle cells that makes fat a more readily accessible source of energy, and hence your muscle cells are reprogrammed to run faster for longer without feeling fatigued. And this is what got GlaxoSmithKline interested in Cardarine in the first place, its ability to increase skeletal muscle's consumption of fat, and hence reduce blood cholesterol levels, protecting those who are at risk from heart attacks and strokes, among many other things. But then, they got far more than they bargained for. Cardarine was able to improve exercise performance in an animal model by over 70%, with a notable shift from carbohydrate to fat metabolism. It's important to recognize that Cardarine did not achieve those effects when administered alone, but was only effective in conjunction with exercise. Therefore, it's not really a substitute for exercise, but it augments the effects of exercise on the body. And reprogramming cellular fat metabolism isn't the only way that Cardarine does that. But before we move on, let me tell you what I think the worst thing about YouTube is. It's people who lie to you and dress up those lies as scientific facts, and I try my best not to be one of those people. That's why you should find a link in the description below to a PDF document that contains a list of all my references so you can have a read of them yourself if you want to. In that same PDF document, you'll find a brief summary of everything that I've mentioned in this video. So if you want to download it, it's down there. And while you're down there, tell me in the comments whether you would ever consider trying something like Cardarine, something that would allow you to achieve your athletic or your fitness goals in a much shorter time frame. I'm looking forward to hearing what you guys think. Cardarine also improves exercise performance by improving blood flow to skeletal muscle through promoting angiogenesis, a process whereby new blood vessels emerge off of older ones. This is obviously something that is desirable if you're looking to improve blood flow to skeletal muscle and hence exercise performance, but perhaps not in the case of tumor development, as angiogenesis appears to be a central determinant of whether a benign tumor turns malignant, spreading to distant areas of the body, and also meeting the feeding demands of the ever-growing primary or original tumor. And so long-term administration of high doses of Cardarine on rats and mice resulted in multiple tumor growths, everything from colorectal to uterine cancer. You can see why GlaxoSmithKline decided to abort all research into Cardarine at that point. One thing that really sticks out though is the high doses of Cardarine that the scientists decided to use in these animal studies. The scientists, they dosed the rats and mice with anything from 30 to 100 milligrams per kilogram of Cardarine each and every day. This is quite significant, as another study on obese monkeys was able to demonstrate Cardarine to be effective at lowering blood cholesterol levels at doses as low as 0.3 milligrams per kilogram. You can see from the table how the HDL or good cholesterol significantly increased, while triglycerides, the bad cholesterol, fell in a dose-dependent manner. This study, along with several other studies using lower doses of Cardarine, did not show Cardarine to have any significant adverse effects. And for context, if this is what 0.3 milligrams of Cardarine looks like, then this is what 30 milligrams of Cardarine looks like. Effectively, it's 100 times the original dose. It's obvious that Cardarine has a narrow therapeutic index, meaning that the difference between the therapeutic and toxic dose is smaller than we would ideally like it to be. The thing is, we already have plenty of drugs like lithium, warfarin, and digoxin, which all have a narrow therapeutic index. Anyone who is prescribed warfarin or lithium will typically get regular blood tests to make sure that they're within this narrow therapeutic window, the pharmaceutical Goldilocks zone, if you like. This is because these drugs, they are all in the habit of accumulating inside your body. When Cardarine accumulates and activates all the PPAR Delta receptor proteins around, it will look for other receptors, other targets to attach to, which may explain the poor survival rates and the increased incidence of cancer associated with doses higher than 10 milligrams per kilogram per day. So why abandon Cardarine research when there are other drugs out there like warfarin, lithium, and digoxin, which are prescribed every single day, despite having a very narrow therapeutic index? Well, it's probably to do with the fact that all these drugs are necessary, as in they save people's lives every day. And while Cardarine may be really effective at reducing blood cholesterol levels, we already have other drugs out there that are very effective at doing that.
Statins.
And they're also pretty safe. So why take an unnecessary risk? So this leaves Cardarine with just one single job, as this magical supplement that augments the effects of exercise, allowing you to achieve your fitness and your athletic goals in a much shorter time frame. And well, I suppose this didn't seem like a very popular proposition to a lot of people, at least legally. If you enjoyed this video, then chances are you're interested in exercise too. And if you are, then you probably will find my video on how exercise improves and protects brain function riveting to watch. So watch it. But before you do, make sure you give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel for more videos just like this. See you next week. And until then, don't forget to exercise. Remember, if you do, you can expect to live 8 to 10 years longer than someone who leads a sedentary lifestyle.